good evening, everybody. Welcome to Awake and our study of the Gospel of John. We are going to start out with a word of prayer this evening, and then we are going to take a look. Let's just put it this way. We are going to go from the depths of hell to the heights of heaven tonight. And one of the most amazing sections you will find anywhere in the Bible, and for that matter, anywhere in literature. Just incredible, awesome things. So let's come before the Lord and let's just prepare our hearts to hear His word and receive everything He desires to impart. Heavenly Father, we bless and honor Your holy name. We exalt You. You're the King of the universe, and yet You are so near and so close to Your children. We thank You for Your faithfulness throughout the ages. In every generation, You bear witness to Your incredible love in Christ Jesus. We pray that this evening Your Holy Spirit would come upon each of us in power, speaking directly into the very innermost recesses of our souls, bringing peace and life and joy and hope through the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ and through His mighty triumph over death and the grave. We pray, Lord, that even though many of the things that we will see tonight are things that some of us at least have heard for years, even decades, we pray that they will be fresh and new and cause us to bow down in absolute amazement and awe before You. We pray it in Jesus' strong name. Amen. Well, we're going to pick up where we had left off last week in the 19th chapter of the Gospel of John, and we're going to pick up at verse 25. I'll just give a quick overview of where we've been. You will recall we ended last week about halfway through the 19th chapter of the Gospel of John with the crucifixion of Jesus. And in that, we saw so clearly how the Lord Jesus is fulfilling everything that was written about Him in the Scriptures. We had ended last time with a quote that John gives from the book of Psalms, from Psalm 22, written by King David 1,000 years before the time of Jesus. And in that psalm, that prophetic, predictive psalm, David talks about what will happen to Messiah, and he quotes, John quotes specifically, "They divided my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment." That's verse 18 of chapter Psalm 22. But as we noted last time, when Jewish people, and keep in mind, John was a Jewish follower of Jesus, who is the Jewish Messiah. He is Jewish. He was Jewish. He will always be Jewish. He comes as the fulfillment of the promise made to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob and to their seed forever. Jesus fulfills the Hebrew Scriptures. And when Jewish people in ancient times and even today quote the Scriptures, Orthodox Jews will quote a section of Scripture, but they will remind you that it's the context of that section, not just the few words. And the context of Psalm 22, as we saw last week, is, my God, why have You forsaken me? Why are You so far from helping me? A company of evil men have surrounded me. Dogs are about me. They've pierced my hands and my feet, and for my garment they cast lots. And here we have John referencing that as those very things happened to Jesus. And so we pick up now at verse 25 of John 19, and this is what we read in verse 25. It says, "Near the cross of Jesus stood His mother, His mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene." Now, I'd like to pause here for just a few moments and reflect on something that John tells us, but something that is also clarified in two of the other Gospels. Matthew and Mark also mention several of the women who were at the cross. And this is the kind of thing that often people read over. And yet what we have here are some remarkable details that give us incredible insights into what is going on and what is being experienced as the Lord Jesus is nailed to the cross. John says that he mentions specifically four women: the mother of Jesus, so Mary, the mother of Jesus, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. So right there, you've got three Marys. which is why it's often very difficult reading the New Testament to figure out which Mary is the Mary that's being referred to at this particular point. By the way, archaeological research in the tombs of Israel in recent years have indicated that what we see in the New Testament fits what we see in the archaeological record. Mary, or Miriam, as the Hebrew speakers would have called her, Miriam was at the top of the list most popular girls' names. And it helps us understand why there are so many Marys when we read the New Testament, because lots of people name their daughters Mary, or Miriam in this case. But Matthew and Mark also mention women at the cross. Now, interestingly enough, Luke does not. Luke concentrates on other things, even though Luke is an individual who, throughout his gospel, spends a great deal of time talking about the role of women in the ministry of Jesus, and Jesus dealing with women in a way that none of the rabbis did. But Matthew tells us that at the cross of Jesus, Matthew 27:56, were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. Mark tells us, Mark 15:40, at the cross, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the younger, and Joseph, and Salome. And throughout the ages, including some of the earliest Christian writings that have survived, we have testimony from very early witnesses that these lists of names apparently are referring to the same people. And here is what we know, both from the evidence of early Christian writings, but also what we're able to deduce from the New Testament. Mary Magdalene is mentioned by all three, John, Matthew, and Mark. They all say Mary Magdalene was there, and that's a given. John mentions his mother being there, Mary, the wife of Joseph, the mother of Jesus. John says his mother's sister was there. And Mark tells us that Salome was there. In addition, Matthew tells us the mother of Zebedee's sons was there. And the prevailing view throughout the centuries is all three of those people are the same individual. Salome is the sister of Mary, the mother of Jesus, and she is the mother of Zebedee's sons, which means that Salome is the mother of James and John, John being the author of this gospel, and is the aunt of Jesus. So standing at the cross is Jesus' mother and Jesus' aunt, and the fellow who is writing this gospel is Jesus' cousin. But there's more. Matthew mentions Mary, the mother of James and Joseph. Mark mentions Mary, the mother of James the younger and Joseph. And John mentions Mary, the wife of Clopas. Again, the overwhelming consensus of the earliest authors is that Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, or James the younger and Joseph, is also the wife of Clopas. And early Christian testimony is that Clopas is the brother of Joseph, the stepfather of Jesus. So these are all relatives. At the cross, you have Jesus' mother, Jesus' aunt, and also the wife of Joseph, the stepfather of Jesus, the wife of his brother. This is family. Now, doesn't that put a totally different understanding of what's going on here? The family is gathered there. The disciples have all run, but Jesus' family, the women, think about that. It's the women. The men are hiding, but the women stay with him to the bitter end. And they are watching what is going on. And so last week when we talked about the agony of crucifixion and what happens when you drive the nails through the wrist between the radius and the ulna and you sever the nerves and there becomes this tremendous cramping in the chest cavity so that you can you're unable to exhale. You can inhale, but you can't exhale. And the only way you can get a breath is to push off on the nail that's driven through your feet and get some air. And then you have to drop down because the pain is just absolutely overwhelming. Jesus' mom, Jesus' aunts, they're watching this. And as all this is going on, so is Mary Magdalene, whom we will find here in the Gospel of John, as elsewhere, to be the first eyewitness of the resurrection. But the women are staying with him to the bitter end. And this really does help us see a number of things. It means that John, the author of this gospel, and Jesus are cousins. And John is the only one of the disciples there at the crucifixion. All the others had run. Jesus is with his family as he goes through the most grueling torture and the greatest agony of soul. Well, John goes on. He says, verse 26, when Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved, that's John, the author of the gospel, when Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Keep in mind, a question was raised in class this morning. Why did Jesus turn his mother over to his cousin rather than to one of his half-brothers? And the answer we get from the Gospel of John is his own brothers didn't believe in him. They had ridiculed him. And apparently, they were nowhere to be found. But Jesus turns to his mother and to his best friend, and he says to Mary, "Woman, behold your son." And by the way, that sounds rather cold and impersonal to us. But keep in mind, in the New Testament era, speaking and calling an individual woman was a sign of respect, in many ways similar to madam or m'lady, a very respectful term of endearment, I might add. And Jesus refers to his mother that way also when he carries out the miracle of at the wedding of Cana, and he calls her, "Woman, you know, my time has not yet come." He will use that same term just a little later on in our study this evening to another individual, and you will see it also is an endearing term. It is not a rough way of talking or an impersonal way of talking. It conveys a great deal of respect and love and appreciation. So, "Woman, here's your son," and then to John, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, we're told, John took her into his own home and cared for him as his own mom. By the way, that too is supported by some of the earliest evidence we have from early Christian authors. They tell us that ultimately John, the author of this gospel, settled down doing missionary work in the town of Ephesus in western Turkey, along the coast of the Aegean. And in that, one of the biggest and most important cities of the empire, John carried out his work. But we are also told from early sources that Mary was with him there. And so what we see here in the biblical record is also supported in what we see in some of the later historical writings. Well, verse 28, later, knowing that everything had now been finished and so that Scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." Now, the question has often been raised, what is that all about? It goes on and says, verse 29, a jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. Where in the scripture does it ever say, "I'm thirsty"? And the answer is in one of the Psalms of David, Psalm 64, in fact, Psalm 64, verse 21. It talks about, "I am thirsty," as the suffering goes on of the servant of the Lord. In addition, though, Psalm 22, the psalm that John had alluded to earlier and had quoted, Psalm 22 says, "My mouth is dried up like a potsherd. It's like the dust of death." And that, too, would fulfill what Jesus is saying here. But I also believe there is something else here. Jesus says he thirsts. And for the first time, asks for something to drink. But remember what he had told Peter back in the garden, John chapter 18, John 18 verse 11. He told Peter to put the sword back. He said, "Will I not drink the cup my Father has given me?" And what Jesus is doing here is he is drinking the cup. He's in effect saying, everything that was predicted about me, everything that the scriptures have said, I am going to bring to completion. And knowing that everything had now been finished, he said, "I'm thirsty." He's in effect saying, I am drinking the cup to the brim, you know, taking all the judgment of human sin upon myself. And then verse 30, when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now, please note how the drink was given to him. Did you notice that? They soak the vinegar with a sponge, soak it up, and they put it on the stalk of a hyssop plant. Anything come to mind about Passover and hyssop plants? Yeah, I see some heads nodding. At Passover, what happened in Exodus at the first Passover? God specifically directed the Israelites, here is what you are to do on the night the Passover lamb is killed and roasted. You are to drain its blood into the souf, into the trench at the foot of your door, your front door. And then you are to take a hyssop stalk and dip it into the blood of the innocent victim, the sacrificial Passover lamb. And with the blood on the hyssop, you spread the blood on the crossbeam and on the upright doorposts of your home. Interestingly enough, you're making the sign of a cross as you do that. And the hyssop plant was always associated with the sacrifice of the Passover lamb. Now, the guards unwittingly, but God's in control, the guards unwittingly give him the drink of vinegar on the stalk of a hyssop plant. Yeah. And in fact, as David says in Psalm 69, verse 21, they gave me vinegar to drink. I think I may have said 64 before. I see you nodding your head. Yeah, I meant 69, excuse me. They gave me vinegar to drink. Anyway, he is fulfilling everything, all the bits and pieces of the Passover. He is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So at that point, when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." The word that is translated, "it is finished," is a single word in the text of the Gospel of John. It's the word tetelestai that's printed up there on the screen. You say, that's all Greek to me, but it's a fascinating Greek word, tetelestai. It truly means it is finished. But in surviving records from the first century, we find that it has another meaning as well. Like many words, a dual meaning. And where we find it written is in, of all things, ancient documents that were used by accountants, people who kept a record of what is owed by such and such an individual or such and such a group. And accountants would keep very detailed records. And we found those, especially in the garbage dumps of Egypt. Egypt is so dry that much of the papyrus has survived. And so we have first century documents, everything from love letters to, we actually have a letter from a Roman soldier to his mom and dad back in Rome. And the letter, I mean, it sounds like it could have been written today. It goes like this, basically, "Dear mom and dad, how are you? I am fine. Please send money." But we also find accountant records. And when an accountant realizes that a debtor has paid the full amount owed, we have written over that the word tetelestai, which means paid in full. Paid in full. So as Jesus says, "It is finished," it also conveys the notion, it is paid in full. And do you realize what that means for you and me? It means that every sin, every rebellion against God, everything you and I have ever done or ever will do was paid for in full by the Lord Jesus on that cross almost 2,000 years ago. And when Jesus says it is finished, he's saying not only has he accomplished the work the Father has given him to do, he is saying it is all paid for. So when the enemy comes at you and says, you know, you've done too much, or, you know, he can forgive an awful lot, but he can't forgive that sin, what the Lord says is, tetelestai, paid in full. It is finished. And there is such incredible comfort in that. And there is the assurance that no one is outside the grace of God. When I think of that, I'm just going to turn very quickly here to the Apostle Paul's letter to Timothy. And as Paul writes to this dear friend of his, Timothy, who is his mentee and an individual who, learned everything basically from the Apostle Paul. Paul says the following. This is from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 16 and following. He says, "But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life." What Paul is saying is, Jesus reached into his life, even though he was a persecutor and a violent man. We would have called him a religious terrorist. Jesus stepped into his life and reclaimed him, not just to use him as a mighty missionary, but as an example of his incredible grace and mercy. And what Paul is saying, in effect, is if God can save me, he can save anybody. Tetelestai, paid in full, it is finished. And that's what the Lord Jesus declares on the cross. Now, John does not mention another detail that Luke mentions. So does Matthew, by the way. Both Matthew and Luke tell us the time when Jesus died. And keep in mind, this is a Jewish gospel. The gospels were written by Jewish people, with the possible exception of Luke. But Luke tells us that he gave up his last breath at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. What happens at 3 o'clock in the afternoon in Jerusalem when the temple is standing? And the answer is the evening sacrifice. The lamb is killed. The incense and prayers are offered up, and the crowd worships, and the priest, a designated priest, goes into the holy place, lights the altar of incense, says prayers over the people, comes back out and announces the grace of God. Jesus dies at the exact moment that the sacrificial lamb is killed, because he is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And what do we learn happened at that very moment from the other gospel authors? The temple curtain, this massive curtain that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies, where only the high priest could go, that temple curtain is ripped from top to bottom. And it is a clear sign something dramatic has just taken place. Jesus had earlier said, "No one takes my life from me. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it up again." He chooses the exact time when he bows his head and gives up his spirit. And it's at the very moment that the sacrificial lamb is killed and the temple curtain is split down the middle with the declaration that we now have access to the very presence of the living God. And it's all because it is finished. It is paid in full. Well, John doesn't stop there. He goes on. Verse 31, "Now it was the day of preparation." By the way, day of preparation in Orthodox Judaism is the day before the Sabbath. For Jewish people and for New Testament Jewish people, the day begins at sundown. And so when the sun sets, the Sabbath begins. Now in this case, the day of preparation is the day before the Sabbath, what we would call Friday, or what we call Good Friday. By the way, only one who realizes it is finished can truly call that Friday good. Yeah. But it's the day of preparation. The next day was to be a special Sabbath, John says. And it was a special Sabbath because it was the Sabbath of Passover. By the way, something we learn from the Torah. The Torah tells us that at Passover, on the first day of the week, after the first Sabbath of Passover, because keep in mind, the Feast of Unleavened Bread and Passover lasts a total of 8 days. So on the first day of the week, after the first Sabbath of Passover, the Jewish people were to celebrate a special festival. It was called the Festival of First Fruits. It recognized the coming of the barley harvest and the provision of God. And that particular festival took place on a Sunday, right after the first Sabbath of Passover. So Jesus rises from the grave on the first day of the week following the first Sabbath of the Passover festival. Which is why the Apostle Paul says, he is the first fruits of those who rise from the dead. He rose on first fruits, and he is the guarantee that the rest of us are going to be raised when he returns. And again, it is fulfilling everything the Hebrew Scriptures had declared all along for, in the case of Moses' writings, for 1,500 years. And it's all taking place here before John's eyes. And so John says, middle of verse 31, because the Jewish leaders did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. Now, a natural question is, well, why would they have the legs broken? What does that do? And the answer is, it means that the crucified victims are going to die quicker than they would have normally. The Romans did what they called crucifragium, which is basically they took a Louisville slugger, a first century baseball bat, and they would go up to victims who had been crucified and smash their legs, break the bones of the legs. And what happened is it means that, you know, individuals who've been hanging on a cross now and have to push up with their legs to breathe can no longer push up with their legs. And as a result, they die a slow death of asphyxiation. But it's not as slow as just continuing to hang there. So the religious leaders, they are very scrupulous. You know, we can't have these bodies up here on the Sabbath. I mean, you know, that would be offensive to God. You got to roll your eyes as you read this, you know. That would be offensive to God. So let's make sure these guys die quickly and let's take them down. And so John tells us, the soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. By the way, back in the 1960s, when we actually found in Jerusalem the bones of an individual who had been crucified, a Jewish man, even know his name and the name of his father, when they found those bones, they found not only a nail that was still had been driven in through the wood and penetrated the ankle bones of the individual, they found something else, and that is the legs had been broken. One of them completely, the other just badly mangled. But he had experienced crucifragium, apparently, so they would get his body down also in a timely manner. So they come to Jesus, they find that he's already dead. And then we read verse 34. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. Many medical people have suggested that what that indicates is that this Roman spear went up underneath Jesus' ribs and actually penetrated the pericardial sac. In other words, it was a death blow, went right to the heart. And that's why blood and water would have come forth. Individuals who were crucified often died because of heart failure. and liquids accumulated around the pericardial sac would produce considerable pressure against the heart and lead to, you know, death, a slow, painful death. But now this lance goes in, and we're told blood and water comes forth. Verse 35, the man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe. John is saying, in effect, I was there. I witnessed it. I was an eyewitness. I saw what happened. I know he was dead, and I'm telling you this so that you will believe. Later on, he will say something very similar, that he has written all of this so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. But here he pauses for just a moment and stresses the fact, I was there, I know what happened. Some people have suggested this was actually written in by an outside editor. I don't believe that to be the case. I believe the language is very consistent with the rest of the gospel, and John is just simply reaffirming that he was there, he saw it, and you can trust my testimony. Well, these things happen, verse 36. These things happen so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And as another scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced. And by the way, if you look up there, not one of his bones will be broken. Exodus 12, verse 46, God gives direction to the Israelites as to how they are to handle the Passover lamb. And this is what we read in the 12th chapter of Exodus, verse 46. As God gives specific directions, here's how you celebrate the Passover meal. He's speaking about the eating of the Passover lamb and says it must be eaten inside the house. Take none of the meat outside the house. Do not break any of the bones. We also read in the Psalms, Psalm 34, not to break the bones. His bones will not be broken. And then they will look on the one they have pierced is a direct quote from the prophet Zechariah. By the way, the prophet Zechariah, his writings are the Old Testament equivalent of the book of Revelation. Zechariah uses all sorts of unusual images and dramatic language and symbolism to convey with incredible power. You read Zechariah and then you read the book of Revelation, you say, wow, they sound a lot alike, and a lot of similar themes and a lot of similar words and phrases and picture language and so on. This is what we read in Zechariah's writings. And again, just when you realize this is written hundreds of years before the time of Jesus, but God is speaking here in Zechariah chapter 12, and this is what he says, verse 10, about the middle of verse 10. God is speaking and he says, they will look on me. You get that? They will look on me. This is the living God speaking. They will look on me, the one they have pierced. The rabbis, they looked at this and thought, whoa, what in the world could this be about? They will look on me, the one they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child and grieves bitterly for him as one grieves for a firstborn son. And she brought forth her firstborn and laid him in a manger. And they will look on me, the one they have pierced. God is speaking. You look at this and say, you can't make this stuff up. And we have copies of Zechariah that predate the time of Jesus. We know this is not backdated, that this was written beforehand. And what John is telling us is all of this was to fulfill what the prophetic scriptures had declared all along. Everything in the Hebrew scriptures points to the Messiah, both his first coming and his final appearing. And so John once more makes it very clear, this is not accidental, this is not something that just sort of coincidentally took place. This is fulfilling what God has known all along, because God is in the details. And he always has been, and he always is. Well, verse 38, continuing on, John chapter 19. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. I'm going to stop there. Do you realize how courageous these individuals are? First of all, we read Joseph of Arimathea, and it says he was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly. Joseph was also a member of the High Council, as was Nicodemus. Nicodemus has appeared now three times in this gospel. Only John mentions Nicodemus. Joseph of Arimathea goes to Pilate and asks for the body. And that was an incredibly heroic act. We tend to look at it and say, oh, he was a secret disciple because he was fearful of the Jewish leadership. But the fact of the matter is, at the darkest moment, at the worst possible time, when everything seemed to be lost, Joseph of Arimathea said, enough is enough. I'm not going to allow this travesty to go unanswered. And he goes to Pilate and asks to take the body down and give it a respectful burial. He is in effect saying to his colleagues, what you have done is reprehensible. And I am willing to put my life, my honor, and my fortune on the line. And that's precisely what he does. And Pilate is rather amazed, as we're told in the other Gospels, but he gives permission. I personally think Pilate was doing this. All right. Got back at them. You know, they forced me to kill this guy, and I didn't have any wiggle room. But now they're fighting one another. So yeah, go ahead. You can take the body down. I'm guessing he was chortling. Along with Joseph of Arimathea, though, is Nicodemus. Nicodemus is also a member of the council, the Sanhedrin, and he is also a man of wealth. And so what does he do? It says, Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds, actually somewhere between 75 and 100 pounds. This is expensive stuff. And it's perfectly in keeping with what we now know about Jewish burial practices in the first century, because we've actually found the remains of buried individuals. And, you know, while the bodies have decayed and so forth, some things remain in that hot, dry climate. And we can tell from what has been unearthed that the common procedure was to wrap a body in linen, and in the case of well-to-do people, to actually interleave in the linen wrappings, to place spices like myrrh and aloes in there as a way of showing respect, as a way of keeping the smell down. You know, I would remind you at the tomb of Lazarus, when Jesus says, roll the stone away, and what do Lazarus' sisters say? Lord, he's been dead for 4 days, he stinketh. You know, this is a way of in a very hot climate, trying to bring a little bit of sweet smell and to offer respect to the dead. And so Nicodemus brings about 75 pounds of myrrh and aloes. By the way, myrrh shows up over and again in Jesus' life. One of the reasons when we anoint people with oil that we use olive oil mixed with myrrh, because myrrh is associated with every important event in the life of Christ. When he was born, the wise men brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. When he was crucified, they offered him wine mixed with myrrh. And when he was buried and rose, he was encased in myrrh. Myrrh has a wonderful, sweet, beautiful smell. And every time I smell it, I think of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, you know, to be anointed with the sign of the cross on your head and to smell the myrrh for the rest of the day, it just brings us right back to his birth, his death, and his resurrection. It's powerful stuff. Anyway, they take the body And we read verse 40. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices in strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. And this is one of those instances where a great deal of evidence suggests that we can actually point to the very spot where this took place. Going way back in early history, all the way back to the couple generations after the time of the apostles, there has been a consistent testimony about where Jesus was crucified and buried. And it is described as being outside the wall of the city, in a area where there was a graveyard, but also where there was an execution site, a crucifixion site. The site was reverenced by early first century believers to the point that in around 135 AD, when the Roman Emperor Hadrian completely leveled the city of Jerusalem and rebuilt it and renamed it, he called it Aelia Capitolina. And recognizing that there was one site that was reverenced, especially by Jewish followers of Jesus, he decided to desecrate the site by building a temple to Venus there. By Venus, by the way, the goddess of beauty and sex. So he builds this temple there. But everyone who lived in the area knew that that site marked the place where Jesus had been killed and buried and where he rose. And so in the early 300s, when the Roman Emperor Constantine embraced the Christian faith, he sent his mother Helena to Jerusalem and told her to find the major sites associated with the Lord's death and resurrection. And it was one of those cases where X marked the spot. They tore down the temple to Venus and underneath it discovered the remains of a first century tomb and a massive rocky outcropping, which was identified as Golgotha, or as we call it, Calvary, which is based on the Latin. Anyway, that site today is the site of one of the oldest churches in Christendom, Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And this particular portion of that church, it's called the Anastasis. Resurrection is what Anastasis is, Greek for resurrection. The Anastasis is this massive dome over this ancient tomb. And if this is a photo taken looking up at the top of the dome, the first time Jan and I went to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre back in 1994, that dome was very, very darkened. It has been cleaned in relatively recent times. And the reason it was so darkened is for years, the accumulation of soot from candles burning in the church had darkened the thing. Now you can see the gold leaf, just, you know, beautiful, a beautiful appearance. But it is directly over an ancient first century tomb that many, including many non-Christians, believed to be the burial site of Jesus. And if you look at the base of that massive dome, the Anastasis, you see what is called the edicule. And edicule refers to a shrine, a small building, a shrine. The edicule is built around the ancient tomb. And this particular structure was built in the early 1800s after a fire had destroyed the previous one. But inside, you have to wait in line to get in. You can actually get in and reach through a hole in the wall to touch a portion of an ancient first century tomb. And again, it may sound like the kind of thing where you say, oh, really? And it certainly, to Western eyes, it looks kind of gaudy. But it may well be the actual site. And it is very close to the rocky outcropping that is referred to as Calvary. But anyway, there it is. Now, obviously, when Jesus was buried there, it looked a whole lot different, which is one of the reasons why visitors to Israel usually go to this place, what's called the Garden Tomb. It's a little distance away. And many feel that, you know, this looks more like the tomb that Jesus would have been buried in. Best evidence we have indicates that this is from a different era. But it does have, it's a nice garden area, and it is a wonderful place for worship and prayer and meditation, and probably looks a whole lot more like what the tomb of Jesus would have looked like. We've lost those things. Everything has been leveled down, broken up, torn down, and so forth. But anyway, Jesus is now laid in the tomb, and John then continues his account. Chapter 20, verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." Now, picture this in your mind. Jesus has been buried. On the Sabbath, everything is quiet. No one moves. You go to Israel today. Israel shuts down on the Sabbath. Cars are not moving. Buses do not run. Even elevators observe the Sabbath because there is a Sabbath elevator setting. And what that means is you no longer have to push a button to take an elevator. You don't even have to push a button to go to your floor. No work is done at all. You simply go up to the elevator, and when the elevator door opens, you walk in, and then the elevator door closes. And then you go up to the next floor, and the door opens and closes, and the next floor, and the next floor, and the next floor. Everything slows down. And so on the Sabbath, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, Salome, and Mary the mother of James and Joses are resting and grieving. Can you imagine how deep the grief is? For Mary, it's a fulfillment of a prophetic word that was spoken to her when Jesus was an infant, when they took the baby Jesus to the temple, and Simeon comes up to her and says, "This child is destined for the rising and fall of many in Israel." But then he looks at Mary and says, "And a sword will pierce your own soul as well." And that sounds so harsh, but it is gracious. God, through a prophetic word, is letting Mary know there will be, right now you are rejoicing. You know, hail you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you. You're rejoicing right now, and you're celebrating the birth of this child, and you have just heard a prophetic word about his destiny. But God also gives a warning. The sword is going to pierce your soul, and it's not to scare her, it's to prepare her, so that when it happens, she does not lose all hope in despair, but knows this was decreed by God himself. But the grief is so deep. And so early in the morning, on the first day of the week, as soon as it's at least light enough to move around, Mary Magdalene goes off to the tomb. We know from the other Gospels that other women also were there. But when Mary gets to the tomb and sees that the stone has been rolled away, rather than sticking by the tomb and her other friends, she runs back to the home where Peter and John are staying. And she says, "They've taken the Lord's body. We don't know where they've put him." And it's like insult to injury. First, they crucified the most gracious man the world has ever seen. And now somebody has desecrated his tomb and taken his body. What more can happen? And so when Mary gives that word to Peter and John, John tells us they immediately ran to the tomb. Verse 3, so Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. John is saying, I was faster than him. I got there first. But look what happens next. Verse 5, he bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. Now, we've often commented over the years, that's just like Peter. You know, he just barges in. But why didn't John go in? We're not told, but here's a very real possibility, and it's connected to something we talked about last week. Remember I had mentioned that there is some early Christian evidence from the historian Eusebius, who quotes another very early Christian historian, that John was a priest from the tribe of Levi. What happens if a priest touches a dead body or goes into a tomb where there is a dead body during the Feast of Unleavened Bread? He is ceremonially unclean. And so if that is indeed the case, John may not have been a scaredy cat. John is just thinking, I don't know if there's a body in there still. I'm looking in, but I want to maintain ritual purity, because if he was indeed a priest, he would have taken that very seriously. Peter, however, is not. And so Peter just goes right in. And then we are told the following. Verse 6, then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Compare that with what the other gospel authors say. What it means is this: the burial clothes are undisturbed. It's not like someone has stolen the body or unwrapped the burial cloths. They are lying there undisturbed. And you look at that and you say, what happened? What in the world has taken place? What in heaven has taken place? The cloth still lying in its place. Finally, verse 8, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. And when he realized there's no dead body in there, the body is gone. There's no one else in here. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. What did John believe? Well, at least he believes something remarkable has taken place. This is not your run-of-the-mill grave robbery. But they still didn't understand, even though Jesus had said it over and over again. The Son of Man will be handed into the hands of sinners, of the priests and the Romans. He will be killed and crucified, and on the third day he will rise. Yeah. They still didn't understand that. Verse 10. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. But, verse 11, now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. So what had happened here? Mary had run back to the house where Peter and John were, told them, they've taken the Lord's body, we don't know where they've put him. Perhaps ministered to the other women or cried with the other women, or, you know, distraught, what is going on? Peter and John leave and they head off to the tomb. And later, Mary decides she'll go back. But apparently, their paths did not cross. And when Peter and John went back to the house and Mary went back to the tomb, they didn't see one another. So Mary gets to the tomb, and there is no body. There's no Peter. There's no John. She's all by herself outside the tomb early morning at the break of dawn. She is standing outside the tomb crying. And it says, as she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. Now keep in mind, in the Scriptures, what do angels look like when they appear to human beings? The answer is, they look like human beings. They're not those little cherubs with the tiny little wings on their back, you know, and the little diaper on, flying around in the air. No, they appear as glorious human beings, white robes, often shining, but they look very real and very human. And so Mary sees two angels inside the tomb. Isn't it interesting? What did Peter and John see inside the tomb just moments earlier? They just saw burial clothes, right? Why is it that the angels appear to the women? Why is it that Jesus first appears to the women? And the answer is, the women stood behind him, even at the worst time. And he breaks every social convention because he honors those who are faithful and he blesses those who are obedient. By the way, no one can read this in the 21st century and say, oh, that just sounds like a made-up story. Because in the first century, women were not allowed to testify in court. Their testimony was considered unreliable. Now, that's not what the Bible teaches, but it is what the culture observed. And if you are going to invent a story about the resurrection of the Messiah, you are not going to have the first eyewitnesses as women who see the angels and who see Jesus before anyone else. This is not what you would invent. And what we'll learn in just a second is the first eyewitness to Jesus' resurrection is none other than Mary Magdalene. I am sure that caused all sorts of embarrassment for the early followers of Jesus, as they said, the Lord is risen from the grave, and their opponents said, oh yeah, well, who's seen him? Who was the first one to see him? And they would respond, Mary Magdalene. Who's that? Mary Magdalene. What was that first name? I didn't catch it. Mary. Oh, his dad wanted a girl, huh? You could say, this would be the source of ridicule. But if you're going to invent a story, this is not the one you invent. Why would this be written down? Not just by John, but by Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The reason is because it's what happened. It's remarkable. It's unexpected. It's true. And it has the ring of truth. And so they asked her, verse 13, woman, why are you crying? They've taken my Lord away, she said, and I don't know where they put him. At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. Why didn't she realize it was Jesus? Well, one, she'd been crying all morning long. You know, when you've been crying and when you're just exhausted with grief and weeping, it's hard to see anything. But I think even more significantly, she wasn't expecting to see him. They went there expecting to see a grave robbery. And instead, she encounters a living Messiah. And so she says, they've taken my Lord away. I don't know where they've put him. At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. He asked her, verse 15, woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for? Thinking he was the gardener, she said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him. You know, over the years, there are many people who have debated the identity of Jesus. Some say he is a great teacher. Some say he was a prophet. Some say he was a miracle worker. Some say he is a great religious leader. This is one of the most interesting observations. He's a gardener. And then Jesus said to her, verse 16, Mary. She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher, my teacher. When he speaks your name, then you suddenly realize this is real and this is true. And when Mary hears her name from the lips of Jesus, in an instant, she knows who he is. And she is absolutely overwhelmed. She was at the cross. She saw how badly he had been scourged and beaten. She saw how the nails were driven into his hands and into his feet. She saw, after he had breathed his last, how the lance was stuck up into his side and penetrated the heart. And now there he is. And he is alive. And her response is to basically fall before him and grab onto him. And Jesus said, verse 17, "Do not hold on to me, for I've not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Don't hold on to me. It is too mild for the actual words that are used in the Greek text of the Gospel of John. The words that are used there are very, very specific and very, very powerful. Literally translated, they mean stop clinging to me. And not as a rebuke, not, you stop clinging to me. It's rather, Mary, you don't have to hang on to me. I haven't yet ascended to the Father. You go tell the disciples what you've seen. And then I will ascend to the Father, to my God and your God. Now, Jesus is true God and true man. But he refers to the Father as my God, because the Father is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he is also saying something else. He has always called him my Father. And so now he is saying, I am going to my Father and your Father. And that's how he's taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven. To my God and your God. And what he is saying is, everything has changed in an instant as all the Hebrew scriptures find their fulfillment in him. But Mary is just hanging on to him for dear life. You know, you can imagine, this is a woman out of whom seven demons were cast by Jesus. Mary's life was turned completely around by the Lord Jesus. And now she wants to grab hold of him and never let him go. She's hanging on to his feet. And Jesus is saying, in effect, to her, Mary, you don't have to cling to me. I'm not leaving yet. But do what I tell you. Go let the disciples know. And so we end here tonight. This is where we need to cut off. Our time is up, and this is also where we ended this morning. Verse 18, Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. And that is where we stop. Let's close with a word of prayer. And isn't this amazing stuff? You know, even if you have read this and heard this time and time again, you read it and again and you realize that this is real. These are real people. This is what Jesus really did. This is absolutely life-changing. These things are written so that you may believe, John tells us. I was an eyewitness, he says. I saw this. And we're getting to read an insider's account. Well, let's close. Father, We are in absolute awe before you, before our Lord Jesus. We thank you that because he has paid our debt in full by faith in him, we can call you our Father. We thank you that you are our God. We praise you that our guilt has been taken away, our debt has been paid, our sins have been removed as far as the east is from the west, and that we are now freed to worship you, to serve you, to honor you, to live for you. In these coming days, O Lord, may we be filled not only with thankfulness for what the Lord Jesus has done, but filled with the Spirit whom Jesus imparts. Lead and guide us, O Lord, that you may be honored, that others may be blessed, and that those who do not yet know you as Savior and Lord may see in our lives and hear from our lips the precious word of forgiveness and life that Jesus gives. In his name we pray. Amen.